Selamat siang, Bapak dan Ibu semua, Ibu Gubernur, Jawa Tengah. First of all, back to the right hand. Let me, this is a forum kebijakan pembangunan seminar. So the FKP seminar is normally a collaboration with Australian National University of Indonesia Project with the host for this month different institutions. But this week is a bit special because the host is center where I come from, which is SDG Center of Universitas Pajajaran, the center that was established by the rector a year ago. Then actually tried to confirm research and study under the umbrella of sustainable goals within the whole university. And Eduardo is an AIF, I call him Ed. So Ed Gomez is one of our partner in doing research collaborations, and I'd like to introduce a little bit about him. So Ed is an associate professor now at King's College, London, and he's actually a political scientist who published a lot in health issues. Ed got PhD from Brown, and also MA from Brown, but he also I think graduated from Chicago. Another master from
University of Virginia.
Oh, Virginia. So he got two master degrees for some reason, and not PhD. And now he's going to talk about geopolitics in health. I'm really looking forward to hear about specifically to what the obesity aids and food policies in BRICS economies and its implications to Indonesia. What we need to talk about is more about BRICS country. That's why I think it's quite interesting, because most of the FKP seminar is on Indonesia. I think the highlight of some other development case study in other country would be even better for us to learn something that we don't know. Something we know, or not, something we don't know. But he also will talk about the implication of BRICS. So I really look forward to it, okay? So,
thank you all for coming out to my lecture this afternoon. I know all of you have very busy schedules, and so I appreciate you taking the time to come out. Well, I love being here in Indonesia. It's my second time, my first time at the University of Indonesia. Thank you for organizing this. I'm from Washington, D.C. in the United States, but now I live and work at King's College London in London. And as Rich said, I'm a political scientist by training, my PhD in political science, and my research focuses on applied institutional and governance theory to help policy reform in emerging economies. So I've been primarily focused on Brazil for most of my career, but now I've done a book on the BRICS countries, comparing Brazil to India, China, Russia, South Africa. And now I'm doing research on Bukit Arif and Andy Sumner on Indonesia, comparing Indonesia to Mexico, Brazil, on overweight, obesity, diabetes policy, which is an epidemic that I think is affecting all of these emerging economies. And so I'll be talking about that in the BRICS and Indonesia later on. The topic of my presentation today is called Geopolitics and Health, Confronting Obesity, AIDS, and Tuberculosis in the Emerging BRICS Economies, Implications for Indonesia. This is a book that's going to be published with Johns Hopkins University Press this November. It's available on Amazon if you're interested in buying a copy. I just thought that it would be a great idea, as Arif said, to talk about the research I do in this book. This book is different from most in that it applies international relations and health governance theory to health policy issues in these emerging economies. Most researchers that work on obesity, AIDS, tuberculosis are epidemiologists, medical doctors that work on epidemiology of these diseases, the growth rate, how governments responding to treatment. But this project is very different because as a political scientist, I look more at the role of political institutions, at history, at the role of international relations. And as the title and tale implies, geopolitics, international relations, and power relationships between the national institutions and governments is a very strong force throughout the book. And as I'll show you, this is more important to these emerging economies than domestic civil societal
responses and protests are more effective responses. But this project started 5 years ago and revolved around several different questions that I had. This is the outline I'll be talking about today. I'll be presenting research questions and arguments. Then I'll be talking about responding to obesity and AIDS in Brazil and in China, responding to AIDS and tuberculosis in Russia and South Africa, then talk about the implications and the conclusion. There are some puzzling research questions that I had during this project. The first one is, the risks are similar in their geopolitical aspirations, their institutional structures, but why were they so different when it came to responding to health epidemics? You would think that because they're emerging economies, they would all have incentives to respond immediately to public health threats that may threaten their economies, their institutions, their societies. But what I found throughout this research is that that wasn't the case. There was a substantial delay, a decade or more, to these new public health threats. The second question is, why do these nations vary in the timing and the depth of what I call centralized policy response? A centralized policy response, I argue, combines both formal and informal processes for maintaining central government influence within the context of healthcare decentralization. So we all know what decentralization is. We know that decentralization entails giving local governments fiscal administrative responsibility. There are different types of decentralization. Devolution is when both fiscal and administrative responsibilities go to the local governments. Deconcentration, which I understand is more prevalent here in Indonesia, is when the center retains the fiscal powers, but the local governments have administrative policy-making implementation responsibilities. But centralized policy response entails a formal process of using conditional transfers to municipal governments to fund prevention programs in exchange for complying to the national policies. And informally is when the central government uses NGOs or civil society to monitor local policy. So these two processes allow central governments to maintain some kind of influence within the context of decentralization. And so my question was in this project, why wasn't Brazil was able to achieve this outcome in response to obesity and AIDS when these other countries weren't? All these countries are similar because they are large geographic countries, right? The BRICS, high level of decentralization, large populations. But Brazil was the only one that was successful in designing this centralized policy response amidst decentralization. And so that was my question throughout this whole research: why was Brazil able to do this? My argument, in contrast to most studies looking at health policy in emerging economies, is that the international community matters most in telling us when and how governments respond. And in order to further develop this idea, I introduced the concept of geopolitical positioning. Geopolitical positioning entails the interests and incentives of political leaders to respond to international criticisms and pressures for an improved response in health epidemics through strong policy reforms. The different domestic and foreign policy strategies that this entails, and leaders' willingness to pursue international financial and technical assistance to achieve their policy reforms. Geopolitical positioning has two elements, positive and negative element. When it comes to positive, this happens when policy reforms are used by governments to increase their international reputation. They are receptive to international financial and technical assistance, and they engage in foreign aid diplomacy to consolidate their reputation as countries that are capable of overcoming disease, but also work with the international community to do so. In this project, Brazil, India, and China are best examples of this. In contrast, negative geopolitical positioning occurs when politicians do not care about responding and increasing their international reputation in response to international criticisms and pressures. They seek to provide foreign aid rather than technical assistance, and they strive to consolidate their power through the provision of foreign aid and help. And in this case, both Russia and South Africa are seen as examples of this process. But history also matters. Where does this positive and negative geopolitical position come from? And throughout the book, I argue that there are several historical precedents to both these elements. The percent of positive you, in Brazil and in China, takes 3 or 4 positive pigments to get a national reputation building and development of public health. It's 4 or 1 positive pigment to peaceful international cooperation. And also, history of government receptivity in international financial technical systems are all historical precedents that lead to this positive geopolitical positioning. For negative geopolitical positioning, foreign policy legacies of international leadership of world power and public health, foreign policy legacies of government independence, sovereignty, and autonomy from external influence leads to this negative positioning. This is the cases of Russia. The civil society also matters. Geopolitical position provides necessary but insufficient condition. In order for centralized policy response to occur, geopolitical positioning has to be combined with strong government civil society partnerships. Ministries and councils need to establish these strong partnerships with civil society to achieve this centralized policy response. Partnering with civil society increases bureaucratic legitimacy and ability to secure ongoing funding in the central government, so stronger partnerships with civil society and NGOs, the more likely health officials are able to obtain more funding and technical support from the national government to implement centralized policy response. Of all the BRICS countries, Brazil was the only one to combine both positive geopolitical positioning and strong state societal relationships and partnerships. Brazil is the only one to positively respond. Geopolitical positioning entails positively responding to national criticisms, working with the national community to receive financial assistance. Brazil did this for AIDS and obesity, but also provided coordinated diplomacy while at the same time working very closely with NGOs at the domestic level to implement policies. And I'll explain that more and more in detail in the case studies. Let me now turn to the cases of other BRICS and discuss how this plays out in the period. All of these countries in BRICS have gone through nutrition transition. And this is first coined by a very top-name professor at UNC Chapel Hill. The nutrition transition is when countries move from challenges of malnourishment and poverty quickly to overweight and obesity. The nutrition transition entails changes in lifestyle in nutrition, moving from a traditional diet to more a Western-based diet. You know, right across the street before eating today, I saw McDonald's 24 hours. And that's evidence of a transition from traditional foods to more Western-based or contemporary foods. And these emerging economies, the BRICS, Indonesia, Mexico, all along this process very, very quickly in the past 2 decades. The BRICS experienced this transition due to several factors. Increased international trade, availability of foods, cheaper foods, high calories that are present, less physical activity, longer working hours, anti-poverty programs. In the case of Brazil, one of the arguments why obesity and diabetes has emerged as an epidemic is because of the Bolsa Família program and its stipend to poor families. Now, families now have more money to purchase cheaper foods, so there's less regulation than what is being purchased by these anti-poverty programs. So researchers have found a link between increased income on the poor and increased consumption of fatty foods that lead to overweight, type 2 diabetes. And also culture in all these countries, Brazil, India, China, where I talk about obesity, there are some cultural reasons why obesity, why the government didn't respond. And as I was explaining, being perceived as overweight was in many ways, in many instances, seen as a good thing, being nutritious, having well. So there's some cultural evidence of reasons why obesity emerged. Brazil, India, and China all face an obesity epidemic, probably starting in the 2000s. And I have some graphs here to show you the extent to which obesity has increased. Here you have overweight obesity, lean body mass index, trans fats, 2008. We're looking at our highest levels of obesity. obesity next to men. Obesity in India has also increased by less index between 1999 and 2006. And as well as the low in China, there's been a BMI increase. The top of the blue in the way on the very top indicating BMI greater than 25 and red line at less than 18. In all these studies, I talk about how the central government did not respond immediately to the obesity epidemic. And in some cases, why? Have to do with lack of attention, government not interested in believing that obesity was seen more as a public health problem for the middle class or for the richer classes. As I mentioned earlier, changes in lifestyle, increased technology, but also a lack of general knowledge, nutritional knowledge, about what is good to eat in these emerging economies during the 1990s to the early 2000s was not prevalent. So these factors contribute. But as I mentioned also, in Brazil, anti-poverty programs, the Bolsa Família program was also a reason. Culturally, as I mentioned, especially this was the case in India and China, the government society viewed being overweight as a positive thing in many ways because of the malnourishment problem in the past. In the case of China, it was very interesting. We even had propaganda showing how it was okay socially to be perceived as obese, and even for children. For example, this is a picture of a traditional Chinese New Year poster, which depicts a young child as being overweight and obese. And this is a poster card that's very popular in China. And so it gives the social image in society that it's okay for your children to be somehow overweight. But also in China, for many years, we talk about, and this is the wonderful work of Christopher French, who's done a lot of research on this issue. Children have been rewarded by their parents by going to McDonald's, for example, or Kentucky Fried Chicken. For many years, KFC and McDonald's is seen as also a very popular thing to do in the middle class. You see a lot of the middle and upper classes going to these establishments for food, which is interesting because in the US and to a certain extent in the UK, it's perceived as a negative thing if you're a rich person to go to these establishments. But the rate of growth of Kentucky Fried Chicken in these establishments has increased dramatically in China. For example, I recently in my book talked about the growth rate being 13% higher, the growth rate of 13% per year as opposed to 2% in the US for the number of Kentucky Fried Chickens being open in Beijing. So there is a massive increase in domestic and foreign investment in opening up these fast food chains. So these are some of the factors that led to the rise of obesity suddenly in these countries, and a lack of government response during this period. There's very little assistance provided to the governments, essentially no sort of society mobilization in response to the epidemic. In the early 1990s, you also had the AIDS epidemic that occurs. Initially, Brazil, India, China did not respond to the epidemic. We have some graphs that both show the rates of AIDS and deaths increasing in the 80s and 90s. Similarly, in the 1990s, it was the highest growth period of HIV/AIDS cases in India. And same as in China, in the 1990s until the early 2000s, cases of AIDS. In all of these countries, it's very interesting. Despite the government being knowledgeable about AIDS cases, late 80s and early 1990s, there was no immediate central government response. There were prevention and treatment programs compared to Brazil being the one that was most innovative. But there was inadequate funding for the national programs, and especially very little funding for local governments. In all three of these countries, a political elite relied on decentralization, expected mayors and governors to respond to the AIDS epidemic on their own. In response to both AIDS and obesity epidemics, I argue that in the early 1990s, you had international pressures emerging from the World Bank, the WHO, academics. And all of these countries, presumably China, responded positively to international pressures. And this had to do with what I mentioned earlier, positive.
geopolitical positioning. But all the political leaders in all these countries wanted to show the world that they could overcome these diseases. And so when international criticism pressures emerged, they saw this as an opportunity to respond. But in all these countries, there were deep historical precedents that sort of shaped this positive response in this community. And all these countries have a long history of building international reputation for development and health. Foreign policy couldn't do that. There was a long history of working with international agencies in collaborative manner to fight diseases historically such as smallpox, yellow fever. But all of these countries never strove to lead the international community. They're trying to perceive themselves as a geopolitical power, which is in contrast to Russia, I'll talk about later. However, it was certainly the only country when it came to AIDS and obesity to achieve a centralized policy response. When it came to AIDS, for example, as you see here, the National AIDS Program continues to see an increase in national spending by the government, and as you see in this graph, eventually by 2005, or before that, the government's commitment to national AIDS Program spending increases, surpassing that of money given by World Bank loans, which showed the government was not committed early on simply because of World Bank funding, but putting growth its dependence on World Bank funding and started to continue spending. And India and China did not have the same level of financial commitment as Brazil did. And so, at the same time, Brazil was able to create a centralized program called the Fundo Fundo Program, which provides ministry accounts funding to municipalities in order for municipalities, as long as the municipalities have the need to implement the national program's prevention and treatment policies. And so it provides an incentive for local governments to adhere to national policy in a decentralized context. And as you see in this graph, the spending for the Fundo Fundo Incentivos program increased 2003-2010, which is the latest most recent data yet, and to my understanding has continued to increase, showing the government has continued to have a centralized response. And I argue this focus has led to Brazil being perceived as awarded by the AIDS Foundation in 2003 having the best national response to the AIDS epidemic. But there was one critical factor that Brazil had that other in China did not, and that was strong state civil societal partnerships in health. In this book, we talk about since the early 19th century, Brazil's public health officials had a very strong partnership with social health movements. Brazil is very unique among the BRICS in that it has this long history of civil society mobilizing in response to diseases, syphilis, and tuberculosis. And in the early 20th century, there was a very famous physician called Gilberto. There's a very famous physician doctor that worked very closely with civil society. He was in fact a member of social movements in response to syphilis and tuberculosis. And over the years, Brazil maintained this tradition. So when the AIDS epidemic emerged, health officials were very used to working closely with civil society. And when the AIDS epidemic, they had this Sanitarista movement, which was a health movement. It demanded the military partner to transition to democracy, provide universal health care. And a lot of the people working on AIDS at this time came from the Sanitarista movement. So there was a very strong relationship between those activists working on universal health care and AIDS in the gay community and government officials who were also coming from this movement, so that facilitated their response. And then in China, these historical state-social relationships were not present. Different reasons. In both India and China, the government and civil society never worked closely. Both countries were more centralized, planning response to public health, and so AIDS and obesity epidemics emerged. There was no strong civic movement that emerged in the work with the government. And so there were reasons why we saw this difference in policy, centralized policy response between Brazil and India and China. I now turn to the case of Russia and South Africa, which was examples of what I call negative geopolitical positioning. And again, as I mentioned earlier, negative geopolitical positioning emerges when the political leaders don't care about international criticisms and pressures. They don't care about their national reputation. All right? They're not interested in immediately receiving international financial and technical assistance. And they provide for me with the goal of increasing their regional or geopolitical power. And at times, even doing that at the expense of investing in domestic programs. In both countries, the AIDS and tuberculosis epidemics emerged at different times. And unfortunately, I only have the data for Russia, so I'll show the Russia data here. I don't know if all of you are aware, Russia currently still has arguably the worst epidemic still in the world when it comes to HIV/AIDS. And so it was both interesting but also very sad for me to do this research when I was the AIDS epidemic and the TB epidemics emerged simultaneously during the
Ironically, the director of the Russian Federal AIDS
value but firstly, claiming that this happened at the expense of neglecting to invest in domestic AIDS and TB programs. In South Africa, however, neither Mandela, President Mandela, and Benny, or the current Zuma administration have voted have been interested in using bilateral aid or aid to increase the government's true political influence. Instead, in recent years, it's been more focused on strengthening domestic aid and tuberculosis response. The only time the government started to increase its response to AIDS and TB in Russia and South Africa was when it was perceived by political leaders as posing a national security threat. In the book, I document how, by the mid-1990s, both governments saw these epidemics as posing a threat to the military, to security, to economic growth, and how that created incentives for response. What was also missing in these two countries that we saw in India and China was the absence of strong state-societal partnerships. And because of this, both governments have not been able to create a very strong decentralized response to these epidemics. In Russia, you have an ongoing problem with the government not having trust in civil society, not wanting to work with NGOs, perceiving NGOs as being, or registered NGOs as being foreign agents, especially those who are receiving money from Western-based organizations. And that has led to a dramatic decline in the ability of AIDS activists and tuberculosis activists to obtain funding for their campaigns to pressure the government for a response. And in no instance did I see the Russian government trying to work closely with AIDS NGOs to increase more funding or prevention and treatment. And this is an ongoing problem that the media has been reporting about, that my colleagues, activists in Russia, have continued to complain about lack of attention by the central government and an effort to work closely with NGOs to produce a response. In South Africa, similar situations occur despite the current administration, Zuma administration, recognizing the importance of working with AIDS NGOs, TB NGOs to provide services. There is no evidence of these NGOs being sought after by health officials to obtain more information, and no evidence of them being incorporated into the national policy-making process, as we saw in the case of Brazil. And so because of this context, where there's isolation from the international community, negative geopolitical position, where these countries have never been interested in possibly responding to international criticisms, where these governments have never been closely collaborating with the international community, especially with technical assistance or financial aid, and where they perceive themselves as world and regional leaders, in addition to having a weak relationship with civil society, this has been this has led to a weak government response to these ongoing epidemics in both countries. But now let me turn to what does this all mean for Indonesia? And now what does my framework say? What lessons? Well, Indonesia joins the BRICS in confronting the obesity AIDS epidemic. It continues to be a problem here. Obesity, diabetes, as many of you know, has emerged as a public health threat, having to do with the same factors mentioned earlier, increased international trade, changes in sedentary lifestyles. And so these are epidemics that the government will have to release to understand taking seriously. AIDS is also a problem. The geopolitical position suggests that to be successful, the government must positively respond to international criticism, build its reputation, and have to continue to receive international assistance. And this is something that political leaders and government officials here will have to pay attention to and try to see how responding positively to obesity, diabetes, and AIDS can help in increasing what international relations theorists call soft power. Soft power is when nations increase their influence in the world by giving good policy examples. And this is different from hard power, right? This hard power entails money and military power, and showing their power that way. Soft power entails reputation, entails showing other countries what they're capable of doing in a positive way, and having a positive geopolitical influence in policy through that process. So Indonesian government leaders may want to consider how investing in obesity and AIDS and other non-political can increase the government's soft power image in the world. The government, my argument in this book, also, of course, talks about the importance of working closely with civil society, the government working closely, but not in the traditional sense of allowing activists to pressure the government and to have an antagonistic relationship, but rather in a collaborative way where government officials work with NGOs, the whole local governments accountable to obtain information on what can be approved for use via AIDS. And so this kind of partnership as far as Brazil works best. Brazil's case study on AIDS and obesity shows that it's important to work as a partner with civil society and NGOs, not to have an antagonistic relationship where the NGOs are always demanding something and pressuring the government. Of course, that was important during the early years of the AIDS epidemic when we would be trying to get access to drugs and medicine. But after that process, when drugs were available, NGOs started to work in a more collaborative manner with the national government. That's the kind of relationship that I think Indonesia would be pursued to be effective in combating AIDS and obesity. But there also needs to be improvement in decentralization processes. And I know this is a big buzzword in Indonesia and a lot of emerging economies on how to improve decentralization. But one good thing about Indonesia is that the centralized government has a very strong presence in a decentralized context. And in my book, I argue that that's important for combating public health epidemics. So there already is an institutional backbone or precedent where the government already is directly involved, but they need to get more involved in different ways now. Rather than just containing the financial power and revenues for healthcare at the central level, the government also, for the case of Brazil shows, needs to provide additional grants and incentives through additional grants targeted at prevention programs and treatment programs, but with a conditionality that the government, the local governments are showing that they're actually using this money effectively. And that's what the case of Brazil shows, that it's something that the government could do when it comes to obesity. How does the Central Ministry of Health, for example, provide additional grants to local governments to address obesity in schools or diabetes in schools? And so the case of Brazil shows that this grants, conditional grant assistance is also very important. But also having central government involved in policy making at the local level. I know that sounds contradictory for a decentralized context, but as I argue in the BRICS countries, decentralization at the beginning of the epidemics was not the solution. Alright? And so when it comes to public health emergencies, I do argue and believe that central government does need to play an important role. But this may not be the case for all aspects of healthcare. In fact, in the book, I conclude that my narrow focus on public health, obesity, AIDS, and tuberculosis overlooks the larger issue of health systems reforms in these countries, and that local governments play a very important role in health systems reform. And just because Brazil was very good at responding to obesity and AIDS doesn't mean that Brazil has all of the answers. In fact, Brazil has a lot to learn from other countries in improving its healthcare system, providing additional workers, additional doctors in hard-to-reach areas. A lot of these countries, Indonesia, Brazil, Mexico, India, China, are very, very large democracies with limited resources at the rural government level. That's a hurdle that all these countries are trying to face. And then we now conclude with some general conclusion about the BRICS. The BRICS are emerging BRICS nations. They seem to be very similar in their importance and world aspirations. All of them are aspiring to be world leaders, but everyone knows that they create new BRICS development bank, they still have a lot of influence within the IMF and the World Bank. But they are very different when it comes to responding to health epidemics. I thought this was very interesting. And not all of them are interested in, equally as interested in, overcoming public health challenges, which you think should be the case if you want to be a world power. When compared to each other, Brazil shows that nations striving to build their international reputation while working closely with civil society are more effective responders. Right? So you need to combine both positive geopolitical positioning and strong government civil society partnerships to have an effective response to AIDS and tuberculosis. Civil society is important for ongoing positive reforms, but but not in the traditional sense of mobilized and pressuring state for reform. Rather, civil society provides winning ideas and legacies of success that bureaucrats can use for their advantage. So one major lesson we learned from this book is that bureaucrats need to learn how to use civil society and NGOs as a resource to increase their legitimacy and influence within the government. And how can they do that to obtain more financial support from the government, but also other international organizations? So this still shows that there are some ways that bureaucrats can themselves benefit from working with civil society, that we need to focus on that, rather than the traditional idea that civil society is only important for pressuring the government, being confrontational in government, for policy reform. And then at the end of the book, I talk about other groups really emerging. Well, one of the problems that we've had as scholars of emerging economies is that when we focus on the BRICS and other emerging economies, we're very narrow-minded. We only focus on the economy. We only focus on infrastructure. But we need to put as much focus on healthcare and education. And at the end of the book, I challenge these people to have these new acronyms like the BRICS or the CIVITS, China, India, Vietnam, Indonesia, Turkey. And these are all acronyms that are capturing these governments' potential economic prowess. But many of these countries wouldn't be there if we focused on their public health effectiveness and responding, providing universal health insurance effectively. And so we need to refocus our energies on looking at these other factors and in the emerging economies. And the BRICS are still relevant because they do have large major economies with a lot of potential, much like in Indonesia, with a lot of strong healthcare workforce. They have the potential, and they have the ability to magnify their policy experiences. And so they are very important for us to potentially learn from, so they thus pose a large responsibility on them. But that's what this book talks about, and that's what I found in the case of the BRICS. There's still a lot of work needs to be done in confronting public health challenges there. Obesity and AIDS are just two, and those are specific diseases. There are a wide range of diseases that these governments need to respond to. And I think Indonesia is in a good position to learn from these countries. And of all the BRICS countries, I think that China and Brazil probably have the best examples to learn from, because China and Brazil still have a very strong central government focus or influence within a decentralized context. So in the future, we're very interested in doing a comparison between Indonesia, Brazil, and China on how to reform decentralization and healthcare systems to improve government responses to obesity, but also type 2 diabetes and the ongoing AIDS epidemic. So that's my presentation for today, and thank you very much for taking the time, and I'll open up some questions.
Thank you. At present, we are working together with the WHO Indonesia to promote the implementation of the preventiveness regulation of sugar, salt, and fat for the Indonesian community. The problem is this regulation has been accepted to be implemented in 2016, which was a year ago. But then it was inhibited by a group of economists who tried to say that the economy will collapse, or maybe not collapse, but will reduce literally if we implement this regulation. I think I need to inform you that this sugar, salt, in fact, regulation is very connected with the degenerative diseases, diabetes. Now we know that the mortality in Indonesia is very high due to the heart attack, strokes, diabetes, cancer. If you go to Malaya, what is Malaya in English?
Funeral.
We participate in the funeral occasion, and for the, within the last 10 years, we know that we participate in the funeral of a person who died of degenerative diseases, not because of tea or diarrhea or malaria. They died because of these non-communicable diseases, which are very connected with the food consumption. Okay, you have mentioned about cheap food. Yes, this is what cheap food is all about. Regulation of the Ministry of Health concerning the utilization of sugar, salt, and fat as the ingredients used by food industries to produce sweetened drinks. This is water, but you know that if we drink tea or any kind of sweetened drinks, you can easily drink like 3 or 4 cups of sweetened like this, which is equal to the consumption of 60 to 80 grams of sugar unconsciously. That's only for sugar. And salt, we are now consuming 3 to 6 times of the body needs of salt by consuming snacks like this. I'm eating it now. So we are talking about cheap food, delicious, very attractive, and they said it has very high economic value. But we still think that the economic value of this degenerative disease prevention is much higher than the curing and the or the concept or whatever of these industries. So I'm here so that we can discuss it. What can we do so that we can be assured that in 2019, this Minister of Health regulation about the utilization of sugar, salt, and fat in food industries that provide cheap food to the community can be regulated so that it can reduce the risk of non-communicable diseases, which is actually very expensive. So how do we do it? That's why I'm here and I see all of you from economic people to assure that the government that prevention economy is much more valuable than curing. But how could we make them understand that? Okay.
Thank you very much. Well, this is a fantastic question.
I have a kind of question. Yeah. You are the most relevant question.
Yes. Well, thank you very much. And I really learned so much from your comment. And I think that the case. Thank you. I think that the case in Brazil is a good example of what could you do in Indonesia to make sure the regulation works.
One thing that has Brazil has a very, very, very long history with a very close relationship with the sugar industry. And I was very surprised when the government started to implement a lot of regulations on prevention on sugar consumption, especially in schools. Because the government has relied for many years on the sugar industry, not only for food, but also ethanol and gasoline, all right, and energy. And Brazil is the second largest exporter of sugar in the world. So there's a lot of economic reasons why, like in Indonesia, the sugar industry would say, no, you know, we cannot do that because we need it for the economy. We need to have an advantage. We need to continue producing sugar for the economy. But what happened was very interesting. The sugar industries, civil society, and the government, they worked together to talk about the importance of nutrition, to see sugar in a different way. And what's really important was civil society activism and producing more knowledge in the media, more reports, more publications, but also finding people within government they could share their message with. So in Brazil, they have this federal program called CONESEMS, C-O-N-E-S-E-M-S, I believe. And I can provide more information about it later. But if there is a federal national committee in the office of the president that works on nutrition, and this committee in the office of the president, so strategically located in the presidential office, CONESEMS is a group of health officials, civil society activists, and private industry representatives that talk about nutrition. And President Lula, who was the president in 2002-2003, was very committed to anti-poverty malnourishment. And so he gave a lot of attention to this committee. But one of the key things the committee did was not only about malnutrition, but also about over-nutrition, and obesity, and sugar. And so what was very good for Brazil, what could possibly work here, is having this a community at the national level where there are health officials, where there are private sector representatives, and civil society can talk about the importance and make this an important national dialogue. It seems to me that here, the economists or the private food industries is working against the interests of society and your work of other health experts that are arguing. So what the first thing that needs to happen is to have a more meetings and dialogue with these people that are opposed to the regulating sugar. And then explore how does the sugar industry benefit from, what kind of arrangements can be worked in. It's a very difficult situation because, as you say, it's a very powerful economic force. And the government does retain a lot of revenue from these industries. And so in Brazil, you still have all these sugar industries and fast food chains operating, but they also ironically work with the government in increasing their message of prevention. And so a lot of these sugar industries in Brazil are seeing some positive benefits to, in a way, sharing knowledge about the importance of nutrition. Not saying they shouldn't eat sugar, but just in general, improving knowledge about good nutrition. This is a very difficult challenge. My answer to you and to government here, the first thing is to make addressing sugar consumption a national government priority. The second one is to build institutions at the national level that bring together the representatives from civil society, the sugar industry, and government to talk about these solutions. And I find that in China and India, these institutions do not exist. You know, in India, the government has had a lot of resistance from the sugar industries to addressing this issue. And so it's a very difficult challenge. But this institutional presence and collaboration needs to be present. But also, I think that civil society needs to be very, very proactive. I found that in Brazil and in China, that the civil society has not been proactive enough in terms of increasing awareness and campaigns and research. And I think my role as a researcher and your role as a researcher is to contribute more knowledge and awareness about this issue. This sugar industry in the these sugar problems are a new phenomenon. You know, when I was growing up in the 80s and 90s, this never was a major issue. And now, you know, when I was a child, you know, I was diagnosed with type 2 diabetes. And I was mentioned to a week. I was diagnosed with type 2 diabetes 4 years ago in my 30s, all right? And my parents received diabetes in their 50s and 60s. So we're seeing now type 2 diabetes emerging among the younger population. So what's different today is that younger people who are getting know more about the challenges of sugar. And I think that this is going to be elevated more. But the first step is really to create a dialogue and to work with the sugar industry how to address this issue. And I think last night we did regulation, the WHO review of regulation, very, very important. I think sugar is just as dangerous as drugs, in my opinion. And I think it's a very serious public health matter. But thank you very much for your question.
Low-income students. And we had a program that was funded by the National
national government and the state government where we would provide cooking lessons to families. And they would come to our school and they would learn the importance of cooking differently. And so Latino culture, like Indian culture, Indonesian culture, is very high in pasta, rice, meat, bread, all these carbohydrates that contribute. So one reason why is because by providing that money for these lessons in schools for these families, the schools could hire teachers, they could hire nutritionists to come to give these lessons to families about the importance of eating better. And so these are some of the reasons why, but I think the major role that the government needs to play is increasing prevention and increasing information. But also, one thing I didn't mention is in Brazil, the government spending goes for the national primary healthcare teams. They call them family health teams. Brazil has, like the foot doctors in China, Brazil has this very interesting model of family health providers that travel to houses and communities in poor areas. And these teams provide awareness about how to eat, what not to eat. And even more so, in 2008, the government created the nuclear employee, which is the additional auxiliary teams that are focused on nutrition and diabetes. And so, in addition to the primary teams, say that there's one primary team that visits your house. You then now have another team of individuals to follow up on what was told to you by the primary care team on these other additional things. Like are you exercising? Are you eating better? If you're diabetic and taking your medicines. Now, as a diabetic, I rely a lot on, and I benefit a lot from the NHS in England reminding me periodically about the importance of my blood tests, about my taking the proper medication, should I get my own medicine review. So all of these are the role of the government. And obesity is, I think, one major role in campaigning and just increasing awareness, especially among children that are in families that need to know more, but also for children in schools and areas around schools. And India has recently created a regulation, which I think is very important, where snack vendors are not allowed to be within 50 yards of schools. And so that's one law that's been developed to help children to avoid from going outside of school and getting junk food all the time. Does that answer your question? That's why I think the government needs to be involved.
The cost of eating good food
country that is the most interested in reducing the epidemics is the beverages and startup as the insurance payer. But then again, the prevention, I mentioned prevention through school intervention, through the campaign in schools, campaign in society, lies largely under the purview of the local government, which has no incentive whatsoever to reduce the cost of the diabetes and so with this kind of screw up incentive designs, be it from the individual perspective, from the government perspective, do you have any kind of examples that shows how to align the incentives of every agent in society to work toward more on the prevention side rather than what the incentives we have?
Yes, thank you. That's a very complex situation, but I think in terms of local government incentives, the case of Brazil shows that that the media can be very important, and that politicians are always interested in looking good and showing them doing something good, and the media in Brazil has been very good at highlighting what municipal governments are doing in response to obesity. And so I think that has helped align the interest of the national government and the local governments, and because it has now become such a major issue in Brazil that the media is very proactive in addressing and showing this. So I think more recently, mayors and governors have been interested. But also in terms of financially, the central government has been providing specific grants, as I mentioned earlier, for obesity. That is helping mayors achieve this broader image locally and at the national level. And so by these targeted grants to schools, there are special programs for this in addition to the regular grants that come from the Ministry of Health. SUS is financially divided up. So there's local governments now predominantly mainly in charge financially, but there's also a large amount that comes from the central government. So by these additional grants coming targeted specifically for obesity issues, that allows provides the means to then have municipal governments be more aggressive in addressing this issue and receiving some social acknowledgement, maybe political acknowledgement. In terms of costs, this is where economists and myself do not agree on, okay? And it has to do with probably the ideological reasons, but in a way, in a sense, you're arguing that you might as well get sick in an illness because it's going to be cheaper for you than it is to prevent the illness, right? So the argument is that individual costs is costs more to prevent because of eating well, because of going to get checkups, buying purchasing food, that the individual's better off not doing that because it costs less just so they're being treated. But the problem there is, of course, the illnesses that emerge, the death that emerge from this, but also the burden on the taxpayer and the government, which the health insurance of the government. So, I think prevention is the answer because it prevents these higher costs from occurring ultimately. The individual doesn't see these costs, but you take a look at the government costs and you as the taxpayer, it's going to increase. It's a very delicate situation, so I would argue that, in the long term, prevention, investing in prevention and helping people get access. Now, how do we decrease the cost for individuals for prevention so that the costs are high? Well, some things that could be is subsidies for traveling to primary care centers, or subsidies for buying cheaper foods. The recent studies have shown, actually, in the UK, done a lot of research on this, showed that it is actually cheaper to buy good food than more expensive food. And it has to do with the availability. So one thing that I saw in the UK versus Mexico, for example. In the UK, you go to London, there are a lot of street vendors selling fresh fruits and vegetables. In Mexico City, no. They have Coca-Cola, they have tortillas, they have all these things. You don't see fresh fruits and vegetables being sold on the streets. And that's one reason why UK researchers find that the individual cost for eating that healthier, actually lower than actually eating hamburgers and french fries. Now, there's still an argument, there's costs for cooking the meals. You have to put the time and energy. Yes, that's true. You know, it's much easier for a single mother working three jobs to buy McDonald's on the way than it is to spend 4 or 5 hours cooking and feeding the children. So it's a complex situation, but my argument in this book and my other research is that prevention and awareness and educating families is very important, and I think that would be my solution to your question.
Hello, my name is Sarah. I just come here as a community hero. I'm interested about your topic. Why are you picking obesity, ED, and AIDS?
Yes.
Three topics, because I think they ED and AIDS are actually of okay, it's something that we can be infected once we
yes.
get
communicable.
Okay, communicable. But obesity is far different from just food.
Yes.
So why are you comparing
yes.
three of the
thank you. Yeah.
And my second question is why are you using BMI with 25, not 23.5?
BMI, 25. Okay, thank you. Well, the question of the BMI, that was the only data that was WHO provided. They don't have data on 35, about it. No, 3.5, yeah. They don't have data on that, so that was the only data that was available. And then with the three diseases, I'm glad you raised this question because a lot of people always ask me that, why do we stay as tuberculosis? Well, the first reason is I wanted to choose diseases that were highly debated in public. About the role of the government, right? And so all of these diseases had a very difficult time convincing government officials that something needed to be done. TB, maybe not as much, but even with TB, tuberculosis, there was a perception in Brazil and in China that this was an old disease that had already been taken care of, right? There was already treatment for it. And so there's no need to invest more. With obesity, the government's and activists were always arguing that obesity is a problem of the rich class, the upper classes, and that there's much more to be malnourishment and poverty and starvation that we need to focus on. In India and China, that was a major argument. And so I was really interested in the contested nature of the diseases. I was interested in how governments are overcoming these differences in perception. And what factors are motivating them to overcome these differences and these debates? And I found that international pressures was the key reason for why they came in. But also, I wanted to do more than what most people in social sciences, a lot of people are paying attention to AIDS and the politics of AIDS because it is a major epidemic for a lifetime. So I wanted to look at another epidemic that has emerged in recent years among all these countries. And of course, there are many, many diseases. But I thought that obesity was very intriguing because it is an epidemic that is growing along with the economies. You know, the byproduct of their prosperity is obesity in many ways. And so that I wanted to go beyond what was being done by many agents, looking at AIDS, to look at this other epidemic that is associated with the high growth of these economies. So those are the reasons. You know why? But there's also moral reasons why. I mean, all of these diseases have moral stigma associated with them. Obesity is seen as, if you're obese, you're seen as lazy, and in many ways dumb and lazy. And there's a lot of surveys and studies done by psychologists have shown that employers and government officials, a lot of discrimination towards obese individuals and getting jobs. Similarly, a lot of discrimination for people with AIDS and tuberculosis, with AIDS being immoral, and AIDS being immoral activity, or TB because you're poor. And if you have TB in Brazil, in India, China, you're seen as a poor underclass.
And so I was also interested in looking at these because they have a lot of moral implications in society. So those are the reasons why I did it.
Separate the chapter into a type of disease, or?
Oh yes, the chapter is separate with type of diseases.
So you want the book title to cover the problem?
Yeah.
Yes. Thank you for this second opportunity. I want to ask your opinion about taxing sugar, yes. And also salt and fat.
Yes, well, I think that the best case in Mexico, I came back from Mexico 2 months ago, and now doing research in Mexico with some colleagues on type 2 diabetes prevention. And they have a sugar tax, a soda tax, right? And I'm sure you're aware of that. But the evidence has not been very convincing. And the people that I talked to there argue that it has not affected consumption very, very minimally. The problem is that it's a very, very, very low tax. And even with the tax, it's cheaper than bottled water. So in many communities, if you go to the local store, it's cheaper to buy a can of Coca-Cola than it is to buy bottled water. So the tax basically is not enough. So one lesson that I believe that is if you want to make a tax on sugar, it has to be very high, or else it's not going to have an effect on consumption. You know, there's a good example of cigarettes. Cigarette taxes in the U.S. have gone up dramatically over the years. At the very beginning of the 80s and 90s, they were very cheap, right? And now, the Obama administration puts a higher tax. And there's some evidence to suggest that consumption of cigarettes has gone down in recent years. Now, how do we know if that's really from the tax or culture? But in the case of sugar tax, that is in Mexico, from what I read, is that it has not been very effective. And I think it's because the tax is too low. It's still not enough to motivate people to stop. But we have to remember that sugar is an addictive drug. And if you're used to Coca-Cola, it's very addictive. But also, the culture also matters. Like the gentleman here was saying, Mexico has a very strong culture of Coca-Cola. It is everywhere you go. They even have a museum of Coca-Cola in downtown Mexico. And the Coca-Cola industry is even very involved in sponsoring football games and very involved in the community as a social imaging. So it's a cultural sometimes as well, but I think it's a good idea in principle. I think it's a good idea, but if you want to get serious, I think the tax needs to be much higher. And then that's the problem for the government. How do you bargain with the sugar industries? Because that's going to lead to them to increase their prices. And then potentially, so this is going to be a big problem. But I believe it's a good idea, but if you want to do it, it has to be a much higher tax. And how do we get a higher tax? That's another big problem.
Local production sugars, which is used by the household, and imported sugars that are mainly used by the food industry. So, if we think that we want to propose a high tax for imported sugar, which means that the price of imported sugar to be used in food industry will be very high. But we will not touch the local sugar production, because local sugar production is only half of the entire sugar circulation in Indonesia. And it is used by the mothers who buy sugar in the market. And we know that if we can practically reduce like 10% of sugar intake, we can reduce about 1.1% of diabetes in the province. So if we can reduce the higher and increase just the imported sugar, maybe I will ask your opinion too. Because we want to help the Ministry of
Finance.
Finance. The Ministry of Finance to encourage issue defense. And we think we start with important issue. So I need your opinion.
That's a very good, we have to find compromises, right? I think this is a good compromise to start maybe with foreign sugars and allow for domestic production. And I think that's a smart tactic to get the government committed and get more committed. And then eventually, I'm assuming the domestic sugar production will increase a lot. And then you'll have to visit that issue. But as a first step, I think that sounds like a good idea.
Come back here again with the book so you can
yes.
Sign it.
Okay, absolutely.